wonderful time back there. God bless you so much with all of that. Genesis chapter number 3. Genesis chapter number 3, if you'll go ahead and take a trip in your Bibles there, if you have the YouVersion app, you'll be able to find all of my scriptures and everything I'm referring to there in the YouVersion app. If you're not friends with Faith Family Worship Center in Palm City on YouVersion Bible app, please download the app, ask for our friendship. We will include you in our weekly devotions and also in our weekly message notes that I include there for you to be able to go along with. You can also keep notes in there. You can download them. They're there for you to be able to enjoy. Everyone wants to change the world, right? And that's what I've titled the series, Change the World. Well, why would you do that? Why would you title the holiday series, Change the World? Well, I was thinking about, why did Jesus come? What do we want? What are people trying to do? How do I connect Christmas with the culture, with the world that we're living in today? Because they're not even close to each other at this time. We how many of you know that when you get up on Monday morning and you go to work, you're like, no, Jesus isn't here. Well, if you're there, Jesus is there, but it may be you and Jesus. I get that. You may be in a place where Jesus is not welcome. We live in a world that would love to silence the message of Christmas, the message of Jesus coming to this world to set us free. But we live in a horrible world. I mean, whenever you begin to peel the layers back and you look deep, there's some evil things that are going on this planet. How many of you know that? Amen? And excuse me. And with the advent of social media and the internet and everything else, we're discovering more than we ever wanted to know. We discover stuff we never wanted to know. There's a lot of things in play here, and gives us reason to pause and to pray. And many times are the things that we hear and see that's going on around us. Now, some people have said, I'm going to make the world a better place. How many of you ever heard that line before? I'm going to make the world a better place. And people lined up to follow them and march in step with them. People like Adolf Hitler and Joseph Stalin and Mao Zedong and Pol Pot and Genghis Khan and Napoleon Bonaparte. All these people said this. Well, I'm going to make the world a better place. They made a mess. How many of you know that, right? And here's a truth that you need to understand. Shaping the world to match your image only leads to failure and pain for yourself and everybody else. Amen. Trying to shape the world into your image is going to lead you to failure, and it's going to cause a lot of pain and a lot of suffering. And much of what we see in the lives around us, in our own lives, in the people that are nearest, in the world and the culture we live in, is a result of this. People taking it upon themselves to try to reshape, to change, and to do this. And it made things worse. Hello? It didn't make things better. And we see this in lives that people just give up and quit, and they want to just want to leave life. They can't deal with it anymore because they can't get the world to fit their image. The reality is, it's not a responsibility. That's not our job. That's not our goal. That's not what you and I are supposed to be doing. Instead, there's something else. And you say, what does this have to do with Christmas? Well, it has everything to do with Christmas. We were studying in the Hope Group this morning, for those of you in the Hope Group, you're going to hear some of the stuff I said in there and more. But we studied this truth, why so many people fail to understand the real meaning about Christmas. Why they don't get it? Because many times when you ask people, what is Christmas about? And you're going to get a variety of answers. Oh, wow. I mean, if you want to do your own personal survey this week, you might want to get a notebook. Keep up with all the different answers you're going to get, because it's going to be about family. It's going to be about trees and gifts. It's going to be about lights. It's going to be about traditions. It's going to be, they're going to talk about a baby in a manger. Not quite sure what his name is. I've had those answers given to me. You know, I've had people tell me, I said, what do you think Christmas is? Well, I know there's a baby. That's about it, you know, and then there's lots of gifts. And how many of you begin to realize that the holidays are a lot about marketing, but Christmas is about our faith? Those are two different things. And much of what we say and what we do needs to reflect our faith. The Christmas story does not start with Gabriel and Mary whenever he came to tell her that she was going to be with child. That's not the beginning of the Christmas story. The Christmas story goes all the way back to Genesis chapter number 3. There's where Christmas starts. And I want you to understand this because many times we think about life and we think, oh, I would love for life to be stress-free. Hello, somebody say amen. And as I have said before, when you've died, you'll be stress-free. But until then, you're going to have stress. There's no way around it. We would love to have a life that is perfect, that doesn't have any problems. There are no bills. There are no overdue bills. There are no surprises. You know, surprises. You know those surprises. Yeah, you don't want those surprises. You don't want bad reports. You don't want to be offending people. You don't want to be in arguments. You don't want to do any of that. You want a place that is perfect and without sin. In chapter number 3, Adam and Eve were in that place. It was called the Garden of Eden. And the Garden of Eden was Christmas every day. I mean, just think about that there for a second, okay? It was Christmas every day in the Garden of Eden. They had everything they wanted. They no sickness, no disease, no crime, no taxes. There was no problem. There were no troubles. Everything was perfect. And many of you, I know, because, you know, December 25th, 24, 25, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, you're planning. So how many of you are planning? And you're planning, and I just set you free from perfection. So remember that. But you're planning everything down to the detail. How many of you have ever been around that person who plans everything around to the details? And they frustrate you because the forks are not in the right place. And you didn't get the right dishes out. And you didn't buy the right gravy. We're in the South. We don't buy gravy. We make gravy. Amen. All of these things, it's okay. You don't have to be so wrapped up in all of that because the perfection isn't Christmas. What we see in Genesis, though, ruined everything. Chapter 3, we see a snake. We know it's Satan. We know who that is. Talking to Eve, that's always bothered me, and I'm going to figure that out when I get to heaven, what that was about. But did God really say to you, you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden? Of course we may eat of the fruit through the trees in the garden. The woman replied, it's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die. Oh. That's a pretty stern warning. How many of you know you've got a sign, it says, do not touch, you will die. How many of you understand you won't touch it? Right? Yeah, we touched it. So, verse 4, you won't die? The serpent said, replied to the woman. God knows that your eyes will be opened as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. Oh, he is twisting things seven ways a Sunday. Somebody say amen. He is lying. He is twisting. He's making a mess of the whole thing. The woman was convinced, verse 6, and she saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious. She wanted the wisdom it would give her, so she took some of the fruit and ate it, and she gave it to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. In that moment, their eyes were opened. They suddenly felt shame at their nakedness, and they sewed fig leaves together, and they covered themselves. And it was over. Christmas was over. Everything went downhill from there. How many of you know the rest of the story, right? So, do you realize that God created you and me to have a relationship with him right now and forever? Amen. He created us. He created you to have a relationship with him right now. You are not separated from God. You are not so far abandoned, so far gone. But he wants you as close to him as possible. A life filled with hope. How many of you like hope? Joy. How many like joy? There's a promise. How many of you like justice? Amen. And peace. How many we like the peace? We like being at peace, right? We like all that and more. We call that Christmas, right? Think about it. When we talk about Christmas, we're talking about all of these things. We're talking about a season of the year whenever we're not trying to kill each other. The other 11 months out of the year, well, I guess everything goes. But during this, I don't get it. But during this time of the year, man, we just, you know, peace on earth and goodwill to all men. We'll look at that here in just a minute. But we look at this and we think to ourselves, oh, Lord, if we could just go back to the Garden of Eden. You see, what happened in the Garden of Eden was Satan's vision was to recreate what God had created. His vision was to take what God intended to be a blessing and turn it into death and destruction, to turn it into suffering and sin, to destroy what God had created. Depressing, right? This is everything that Christmas is not about. We're like, no, this is not Christmas. So we understand what God is giving us, and we understand what hell is trying to destroy, to manipulate, to steal everything away from you so that you can't enjoy or understand what it's all about. Satan tempted Adam and Eve to consider something outside of God's will. God said, do not touch the no-no fruit. Don't do that. No. And he convinced them to do something against God's will, sin against God. And he disguised it as something. He said, if you will do it, it will make you better. How many of you have ever fallen for this stupid trick before? Right? Oh, yes, it's wrong, but if I do it, it'll make my life better. And then you do it, and better is nowhere to be found in what has happened. And you're sitting there going, what happened? I think you are saying the same thing that Eve and Adam said to each other whenever they took them. They went, what happened? You're naked. We're naked. Oh, hello. Why that is the thing they noticed first, I don't know. But nonetheless, what could be better than the kingdom of God to be in the Garden of Eden where God could come and visit with you personally? How in the world that Satan would convince Eve there's something better than that? Take a moment and process that through your mind. What in the world? How in the world would you come to a place where you think, okay, we can improve on what God has created? Huh? God, creator of the heavens and the universe, who is perfect and without sin, holy and just, the one who knows all, is all powerful and everything else, and you are going to re-engineer what he has created and make it better. That's funny. That really is. And I really wish this was the response that Eve would have given that stupid snake. You're nuts. Shut up. And Adam should have been somewhere with a machete. He said, yeah, you're done. You need to shut up. That's all snakes are good for, right, Mom? And so, yeah, she agrees with me. And so, it was a place where there was no sickness. There was plenty of food. No addictions. No destructive emotions. No crime. It couldn't be better. But still, they fell for it. Satan tells Eve, and you will be like God. He didn't say you will be God. You'll be like him. You'll be up there with him. You'll be kind of equal with him. Yeah, right. Never, ever in the history of ever has the creation ever been equal with the creator. Never, ever has the house ever been equal with the architect. Never, ever has the painting ever been equal with the artist, the painter. Hallelujah. And we are not equal with God. He is God. Amen. We do not mess with that. That's kind of like up there with things you don't do. You don't pull on Superman's cape and you don't do that. Got it? Whenever we realize this, and we realize that Eve fell for this trick, she saw that the tree was beautiful, the fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom that it would give her. Oh, there's a trap right there that will get you every time if you mess with it. And in their pride, they assume they could eat of the fruit and get away with it, and nothing would change. Get this. They assumed that they could take that fruit. We'll take this fruit. We're going to eat it. We're going to be like God, and everything's going to be hunky-dory, peachy king, fine. Oh, no, it isn't. Things changed immediately as soon as they did it. They thought they could continue to vibe and thrive with God, and everything would be the same, and they would have these wonderful conversations in the cool of the evening that were going to be better than the ones they were having before. I'm still trying to figure that out. That was it going to make the fruit brighter on the tree? Was it going to? I can't figure out what in the world they were thinking that was going to make everything better, because it was already perfection. It was already there. But in their pride, they blew it. Recreating the world in your image makes you God. If you're going to recreate the world in your image, then you have to be God. You got to be in control. And we've lived through enough history where people set themselves up as gods. Caesars were very popular for this. They were to be worshipped as man gods. Pharaohs, they were also the same way. They did the same thing. And people who would try to do this had to set themselves as God or godlike. They had to be the ruler of all. Their word was the absolute rule. They could say no wrong, do no wrong. And as a result, they would destroy everything around them, because in their world, all they could create is failure and pain for everybody else. That's what Satan wanted. That's what he wanted. He knew exactly where he was going with this. He knew what the result would be. There's God's kingdom. You can serve God's kingdom. How many of you know this? Say amen. And God's kingdom comes with blessings. It comes with his promises. It comes with his salvation. And the guarantee is that he does it now and forever. What he gives you, you will keep. You can take your faith to heaven. You can take your hope to heaven. You can take your love to heaven. He promised those things to you and to me. And we can have that right here, right now. But then there are Satan's counterfeit empires, all serving him for his purpose, which is to your suffering and destruction, and to manipulate your life in order to be able to destroy everything around you. Now, one would think that if you've got this choice over here of God's blessings of eternal life, and you've got over here the obvious cursings of Satan's will to destroy you, you would make the right decision. But none of you made the right decision, did you? Because you had to come to a place where you had to repent of your sins. Because you realized, I'm playing on the wrong team. This isn't going to get me. This isn't going to make my life better, richer, more powerful, or any of those things. We fell for the same tricks that Eve fell for. I know many times people ask me, how could they do that? Same way you've done it. In your pride, you said, I'm going to do this. And like a 3-year-old, you got hurt. We've all seen them do it. In A Christmas Story, an angelic choir comes and sings to some nomadic shepherds. Now, there's a whole, just this thing goes on in my mind whenever I read that part of the story. And part of it is, I wonder what the look on the shepherds' faces were. I would have given anything to have a camera there. Angelic choir and shepherds going, huh? And or just sheer panic or whatever was going on in their minds. But the choir sings in Luke 2:14, glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth with those whom God is pleased. You may also know it as glory to God in the highest and on earth goodwill to all men. They sing this phrase to them. And how many of you know this? I think there's even a Christmas carol or two that's built around this line right here. And if you ask people, if they could give the world anything, what would it be? It will fall back to Luke chapter 2, verse 14 every time. Really? I mean, just ask, what do you think the world needs? Peace! That men would treat each other better. That there would be goodwill, that we would take care of one another, that we look out after one another. All of these things. How many of you heard all these lines? Have none of you ever watched a beauty pageant whenever they ask the contestants, I want world peace. You know, everybody has this answer already tucked ready to go because we're sick of strife. We're sick of the arguments. We're sick of offense. We're sick of wars. We're sick of all of it. And the reason it exists is because hell is destroying lives trying to recreate what God has blessed people with. Here's a truth that you may not know. Jesus didn't come to change the world. He did not come to change the world. So take a moment, breathe in. I have not lost my mind. My theology hasn't gone off the deep end, okay? I've read the end of the book, the Revelation. I see what happens at the end. He's not trying to save the world. He's not trying, not save the world. He's not trying to recreate the world. He's trying to restore what was lost in the Garden of Eden. You. The whole reason behind the Christmas story of Jesus coming was to restore you back into the relationship that was lost in the Garden of Eden, so that you would be set free from Satan's plan to recreate your life into destruction, to destroy your family, your marriage, your finances, your spirit, your soul, your mind, your health, and everything else. Jesus came in order to be able to set you free. His kingdom is here. The kingdom I'm talking about there in the Garden of Eden, his kingdom is here. Let me prove it to you. Luke chapter 17, 20, 21. On one day, the Pharisees asked Jesus, when will the kingdom of God come? When's it going to show up? We're waiting. We're waiting for the kingdom of God to show up. Jesus replied, the kingdom of God cannot be detected by physical signs. You won't be able to say, here it is, or it's over there, for the kingdom of God is already among you. The Pharisees went right over their head, did not get it. He's looking at him and going, it's me, guys. I'm here right now to save you. I'm here to lead people back to my Father. I'm here to change their lives. He's here now to change our lives and the people that are around us. Lots of these are going to be handed out. How many of you know that? And apparently $8.2 billion worth of them are worthless. I still can't wrap my head around that. I'm like, just don't give the gifts and give the church the money. Okay. But anyhow, sorry. It's the way my mind works. This isn't the kingdom of God. This isn't the kingdom of God. The gifts, the tree, the all of this, it isn't the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is in your heart. And whenever we understand this, it changes everything, because a lot of people say, where is God? Why isn't he changing anything? Why isn't he helping people? The world is in a horrible shape. He needs to come here. He needs to change the world. No. That's not the goal. He'll deal with that later. And he will change the world. Book of Revelation. Just, if you read it and get nightmares, you're on your own. but don't call me. But nonetheless, he changes the world. And in the end, we get a new heaven and a new earth. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to, don't get attached to this one, because it's up in smoke. That way we're going to get all new. Yeah, I like his plan better. Where is Jesus? Ephesians 3:17, Paul tells us, then Christ will make his home in your hearts. It's here. The whole purpose of Christmas is so that you understand it. Everyone understands Jesus rules and reigns in here. We're not trying to change the planet. We're not trying to change the economy. We're not trying to change government. We're trying to lead people to Jesus so that they will know him as Adam and Eve did. To have a personal relationship with him where he speaks to them and they talk to God, where they understand that he is there to provide for their needs as he did for them in the Garden of Eden. And though we live in a world that is a horrible place, it is not our home. There is a home beyond this place that we are looking forward to. And Jesus came in order that we might be able to say, praise God, thank you, Lord, and to have the hope of eternal salvation with him. This isn't the kingdom of God. This is where it reigns. Over our hearts. Stop looking for him to change the world. It isn't going to happen. Focus on doing what Adam and Eve didn't. Focus on doing something Adam and Eve didn't do. How many of you can learn from other people's mistakes? All right, good. You can do that. Half of you are wondering about that. Let me try this one more time. How many? Give me some thumbs up online if you got it. How many of you can learn from other people's mistakes? Amen? How many of you learn from other people's mistakes, then you make the same mistake, and now you've learned from their mistakes? How many of you do that one? Okay, good. Now we're all on the same page. Great. Remember, she saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. Remember this? Right there is the whole, he said, why did she do it? There it is, right there. There's the why. Why did Eve do it? Why did Adam and Eve eat? That's the reason why. Now I'm going to take you to 1 John chapter 2, verse number 16. Literally thousands of years later, John writes this. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. Okay? You see that there, and you're thinking, okay, what does that have to do anything? Because that is exactly what Eve did. John shows us and connects you to Eve in the Garden of Eden to show you how this works in his time, in our time today. Lust or the desires of the flesh. Eve looked at the fruit and it looked good. It looked delicious. How many of you have ever looked at something and went, I want that? And it was should have been on the no-no list, right? You know, no, don't touch. She don't do that. The lust or the delight of the eyes. She saw that the tree was beautiful. Have you ever noticed that sin always looks good in the flyer, on the brochure? And then you get there, and it isn't the same, but it always looks good, doesn't it? It's enticing. It draws you in. Ooh, ah. And then the pride of life, the desire to make one wise in order to boost one's pride. I want to be smarter because I want to be better than you. I want to be wiser because I want to be able to do this. And I see this all the time. You all do. I see it in my circles, I think, as you do. Somebody's always trying to one-up you and make you look dumber than them because it makes them feel better. Pride of life. Did you know that Jesus was tempted just like Eve? Think about this for a second. Jesus was tempted just like Eve. Verse 4 of Luke. No, chapter 4 of Luke, Jesus is led into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan himself. And in verse 3, if you are the Son of God, Satan's talking to the snake again. If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become a loaf of bread. It is the desire of the lust of the flesh. He's tempting him the same way he tempted Eve. Jesus responds in verse 4, no, the scriptures say people do not live by bread alone. What does that mean? It means God is my provider. If he wants me to have a loaf of bread, I'll have a loaf of bread. But if you remember, the Holy Spirit had led him out into the wilderness to fast and pray for 40 days before this event would take place. So he's like, I don't need bread. God, take care of that. I don't need you. No, we're not doing it. Verse 5 through 7, then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them, the devil said, because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it all to you if you worship me. The lust of the eyes. Ooh, I could have all of this? I could have it at all mine. Mine. We live in a world right now that is driven in marketing for the next 3 weeks of mine, I want it. I want all of it. And now we have the internet, and it's real easy to hit buy. And it's mine. How many of you done your Christmas shopping already? How many you done? You done? Anybody done? You all I'm done. I'm finished. Bless you. All right, let me keep going. Verse number 8, he responds, you must worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Jesus responds back with, I don't need all of that because God is my provider and he is my purpose. He is my reason for living. He's the one who takes care of me. The reason why I'm here is his will. It's not yours. So no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to worship you, you worthless. Okay, I'm sure that the two of them had words. Verses 9 through 11, then the devil took him to Jerusalem to the highest point on the temple and said, if you are the Son of God, jump off. For the scriptures say he will order his angels to protect you and guard you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. Well, that took that out of context. But that's what the devil does. If Satan's ever quoting you scripture, it ain't right. All right, just don't pay attention. The pride of life. To gain the world, to gain Jerusalem's attention. Okay, let's say if he did it, and he went up there and he jumped off, I think everybody would notice. And they would go, that's the Messiah. Here we go. He is the Son of God. But that's not how he was to be revealed to the world. That was not God's plan. That was not God's will. He was not there to gain glory for himself. He was there to give glory to his heavenly Father. And so Satan is taking every one of these temptations, the pride of life, lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and he's trying to twist Jesus, trying to get him to trip up, trying to get him to fail again, like Eve did. And Jesus said, I'm not having none of this. Verse 12, you must not test the Lord your God. Jesus says, he's my power. He'll take care of me. He will reveal me. He had just done it back at the baptism with John the Baptist. He will do everything for me. I don't need you. I don't need your help. You cannot make me better. You cannot make the planet better. You cannot tempt me to do something in order to make it easier for me or any of the rest of that stuff. You are a liar, Satan. You will not test me. Get away from me. Get out. And Jesus won the day and conquered what Adam and Eve had failed to do. That's why that scripture's in there, so that you understand that Jesus did what Adam and Eve didn't. And you might say, Pastor, that's Jesus. Of course he could do that. I can't do that. Then you have missed Christmas. You just missed the whole thing. Because 1 John 2:16 is there to tell you that you will face the same temptations Adam and Eve faced. You will face the temptations that Jesus faced. And the scripture's there to tell us we can conquer temptation in Jesus' name. We can overcome in Jesus' name. That we are able to do what they couldn't do in the Garden of Eden. Because Jesus came to give us the life that is worth living. Your secret weapon that Jesus used, but Adam and Eve didn't, is yours too. The secret weapon. How many of you know what the secret weapon is? How many of you thinking, ooh, secret weapon, that sounds cool. It's not so secret, you just didn't notice. Truth, all right? Philippians 2, 5 through 8. You must have the same attitude that Christ had. Oh. How many of you just got a toot? You're just sporting a toot. Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's not the one we're talking about. You got to have the same attitude Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took on the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. Where Adam and Eve failed in their pride, Jesus succeeded in his humility. Humility is the secret weapon. Humble yourself. That's how you change your world. Not through aggression, not through power, not through arrogance, not through sheer will, but through humility. That changes your world. It will change you. Jesus humbled himself to a place from his place in heaven and took on our human... I can't speak English. I do not know why. I have plenty of coffee in me, not quite enough sleep. Okay, try this one more time. Wow. Jesus humbled himself from his place in heaven and took on our human form so that he could give his life as an example for us to be able to follow. To give his life and as a sacrifice in order to restore our relationship with Jesus. He came to reverse the curse. Adam and Eve were separated from God in the Garden of Eden. Jesus came and gave his life on a cross and rose from the tomb so that we could have that relationship back with him today. God loved us so much that he gave his one and only son. Humility. That's humility. That's not just a plan in action. God humbled himself to give Jesus to us. A baby born to the poorest of poor families. You couldn't get any poorer than Mary and Joseph. Talk about the King of Kings being born in a manger in a stable. Humility. He arrived, and the only people that noticed were some bunch of nomadic shepherds who were out and got visited by an angelic choir and came in rattling something about peace on earth and goodwill and all the rest of that stuff. And a couple of years later, some wise sages from hundreds of miles away show up with gifts. Nobody, even among his own people, recognized it. The king, Herod, at that time tried to kill him for it. Talk about living humbly. He was a rabbi with no formal training. Everybody wondering, how did he get this smart? Where did he get his wisdom? Who taught him all of these things? Pride of life. Jesus never learned from the Bible school of those days, which were worthless. He learned from his father. Even that, we see, we talked about this in class, 12 years of age, he's in the temple learning. Homeless and living as his father in heaven provided. All through his ministry, he was homeless. Humility. Dying a criminal's death on a cross. He was not guilty, and yet he was treated as a criminal. And he willingly went to the cross and humbled himself for you and for me. Christmas is about the humility of our Savior to come and restore our relationship with our Creator. It's about Jesus coming to be one of us. I don't know if you can wrap your head around that one. Even I have a hard time with it. But he comes to be here among us, and our lives are empowered, restored, and given great value through his humility. And when we humble ourselves and submit to his will, to his kingdom, in his power and his glory forever and ever, we realize that the titles and the places, the power, the pride, all the wisdom that we can accumulate, the accolades that we can get on a wall mean absolutely nothing if we cannot humble our hearts and say, Jesus, you are king and I am not. I don't want pride of life. I don't want to follow what I see. I don't want to give in to my physical desires. I want to honor you. And by his grace, we can do so. Christmas is about him, not us making the world a better place. It's about changing lives. It's about humbling ourselves to let him work in and through us into a world that needs him so badly, to change us to be more like him. That's what he wants to do. He wants to take our lives. John the Baptist said something in John 3:30. Now, John the disciple wrote it. It's John the Baptist we're talking about, so you keep it straight. John the Baptist says, he must become greater and greater, and I must become less and less. Now, there's a Christmas scripture for you right there. If you can get that, you got it. It's all about him becoming greater and me. No, this is about him, not me. This is about his glory, not mine. This is about his honor, not mine. He blesses me with whatever he wants to bless me with. And if I have been praying and fasting and I feel like I've been out in the wilderness for 40 days and somebody says, if you'll just speak to that rock and turns into bread, I still want to say no, because God will provide. I don't need their help. God will take care of me. I don't need to cheat and short circuit and to do an end run around God's kingdom and God's will in order to get what I want. I need to trust him. And that's tough for us to be able to do. Somebody say amen. Yeah, you're not the most trusting bunch in the world. If I had 25 different, 50 different, 75 different people in here, I'd still say the same thing. It's not our thing, because sin has corrupted within. It takes an act of faith for us to come and say, I trust you with all my heart, soul, and spirit. My life is yours, Lord. I submit it all to you. Whatever your will is, let your will be done. Christmas is about letting Jesus restore your heart in life. But nothing is going to happen out here in your life until you let Jesus in here in your heart. And that's the message that Satan wants to cancel. He hates that message. He wants to extinguish it. He wants you to turn a deaf ear to what I'm saying. Oh, yeah, you want me to change. You want me to do this. You want me to do that. And he wants... Jesus wants you to give. He wants you to give your life to him with everything that's within you. The only message that destroys all of his plans against you and your family is humility expressed with love. Humility expressed with love. I could do the 3-month series on that alone. I could write a book on it. Humility expressed with, if we can humble ourselves and share this message this season with other people around us, if we can humble ourselves and accept it for ourselves and believe that he is going to restore me. He's going to restore the relationships around me. He's going to restore my heart. He's going to restore my soul, as it says in Psalms 23, to bring back that which has been lost. Gifts will come, gifts will go. Christmas has come, Christmases go. On December 26, what will really matter? What will be left? What will really be in our hearts? 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. What is your prayer today? Is it a prayer of repentance? Is it a prayer of acceptance? Lord, I accept you. I accept the situation I'm in. I don't like it. But Lord, you're my provider. Not my emotions. Not my feelings. Is it a prayer of submission? Lord, your will be done in my life. I've fought your will. I don't want to do your will, but I humble myself and I pray. What is your humble prayer today that you need to pray? Stand with me if you would. Those of you online, you're welcome to hang in here with me for a few moments. With heads bowed. And the only reason I ask you to do that is I want you to take a moment to look in your heart. Don't want you to be distracted by anybody else moving around, nobody talking, or any of the rest of that stuff. Just you and God right now for the next few moments. What is your humble prayer? For those of you online, if you can take a moment right now and do just exactly that, wherever you're at, what is your humble prayer? Lord, I need you. If you can finish this question, I need to pray. I need to pray. What is it that you need to say, Lord? I need you. I have fallen for the pride of life. I have fallen for the lust of the eyes. I have fallen for the lust of the flesh. I've been prideful. I've been arrogant. I've been stupid. I've done things. Forgive me of my pride, Lord. Forgive me of my arrogance. Forgive me for running away from you. Forgive me, Lord. Lord, I want to do your will. I need to pray this prayer. I need to pray. God, touch my heart. Help me. Help me to reconnect with you, to be restored with you, to draw closer to you. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you change me to be more like you. What is your prayer today? What is it that you need to pray in this moment before him? Lord, I humble myself. What are you saying when you say that? Lord, you are God. I am not. Lord, you're in charge. I am not. You're in control. I am not. You're my provider. I am not. You're my wisdom. I'm not. Lord, you are everything. I cannot take another breath, Lord, unless you give my body permission to do it. I get that. I am not. I am in your hands. Lord, I need you. I need you. We all want to receive the love of God, the grace of God, the joy of God, the hope, all the rest of these things. And they're ready and willing and available when we humble ourselves and pray. And the scripture goes on to say, to seek his face, to turn from our wicked ways, then he will hear our prayers and come and heal our land. He will heal your family. He will heal your body. He will heal your future. He will heal your life. He will heal relationships. He will heal your mind, your emotions, your heart. The healing is there when we do what Adam and Eve wouldn't do, humble ourselves. Christmas is the most humbling time of the year. It's about him, not us. And we thank him for that. Lord, I pray for everyone here who is just struggling in this moment. They may be in this season looking at it with dread in their heart. They may be by themselves. They may be struggling with a loss from the previous 12 months of this really just messing everything up. Lord, they may be just in a place right now where this season is so tempting. It's a temptation to to fall off the wagon. It's a temptation to give up and quit. It's a temptation just to walk away from everyone and everything. Father, I pray that you will hold them closer to you, that you will draw them closer to you. You will show up in their lives in a real and a significant way, that they see it, they acknowledge it, they will give you glory for it. Lord, I pray that you will bless them to be able to touch the lives that they will come in contact with, their family and their friends, their neighbors, their enemies. Lord, everyone around them, that what they say and do in this season will be a reflection of who you are, not what we think, what you want, not what we want. Lord, we're not coming to you with a Christmas list of gifts. Lord, bless me with this, bless me with that. Lord, we come to you and say, not my will, but yours be done on earth as it is in heaven. And Lord, we will praise you for it now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Give the glory to God in this place. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. How many of you glad you came to church? Amen? Amen. All right. Now, before you leave, make sure you meet like 500 new people. And God bless you. You may consider yourselves dismissed.